Thank you very much for being here. I think this must be the 10th web session, or maybe more, where we have power as a subject,
yeah,
in one way or the other. And really, you can do no discussion in India about the economy, about change, about society, about anything except power. I see a guest sitting here from Pakistan, former Pakistan High Commissioner to New Delhi, and he will bear me out that in the last elections in Pakistan, the big issue was power. What we call as inverters, in Pakistan they are called UPS. Mm-hmm. So during elections, I go around looking for writings on the wall, and I don't read any Urdu. But I saw everywhere these three letters, UPS, and I checked with somebody, uninterrupted power service. Usko hum, in India, we call it inverter. So power is a big political subject in our countries also, mainly because we've taken so long to address that problem. We've just missed the bandwagon in the past. Just like the Mars bandwagon, we are, Johnny's come lately on power also. Now, pardon me? Somebody? Or somebody at the back, okay. So, the good thing about late movers on the train is that you also know that what mistakes people have made, what lessons have been learned. It's a different matter that sometimes we tend to repeat the same mistakes over and over again, some of which we will talk about now. So, we have a panel of stakeholders. We don't quite have consumers on the panel, and we don't quite have the government, which, depending on how the power sector does, either wins or loses elections. Because in India, we used to say until about 10 years ago that every election was a Bijli Sadak Pani election. That this was about electricity, roads, and water. Roads is the one sector which has really moved. Water is something that is still confined to irrigation. People are not making drinking water a big issue yet. But power, I think, is coming back to being an issue, and that's why all of us are here, because we continue to have politics of cheap and free electricity. I mean, it's one thing to say power is a fundamental right, but cheap or free power is not a fundamental right. And I think that's what has bedeviled our processes. So we have an interesting panel here. We have Mr. Tulsi Tanti. He was a pioneer in wind energy in India. He's been through his school of hard knocks
yes,
with ups and downs in the market, but he is a genuine entrepreneur, is one who can survive a downturn. And Mr. Tanti has Suzlon Power is his company, so wonderful to have you here. We have Mr. Arun Kumar Jain. I just learned to pronounce the name of his company, Fluor. They make power plants all over the world, and they are doing some work in India with Reliance and with BASF, which is a multinational. Yeah. But I also learned from him that you can make mini nuclear plants, like 25 megawatt nuclear plants. Okay. I'd love to have one in my backyard. So you learn new things, new technologies. We have Deepali Khanna, who is a familiar face in these parts, director of Rockefeller Foundation. Deepali leads a smart power for rural development initiative. How didn't we get, did not get it into a proper rhyming acronym? You should put a vowel in the middle and it will become something like that. You should ask our Prime Minister. He's very good at it. So this initiative delivers free electricity on a mini plant, genuinely mini plant basis, to limited users, and collects from them. And frankly, she just told me that they collect 98.7% of their bills. So maybe we now need to divide up all our state utilities and
small,
and make them small. Then we have Mr. Narayan, who we have just drafted onto our panel. Amit Narayan, he knows more about technology. He uses softer technologies to make distribution of power more efficient and cheaper, and maybe you can solve the problems of our discos also. And maybe you can also make sure that Tulsi starts getting paid for his power. So I think we can start left or right. Let me start with you. Since you have the longest experience of surviving in the power industry from the wrong end.
So
the wrong end, because manufacturer is the last to be paid.
Yes. No, the power sector in India, we have seen the last 20 years, lots of reform and transformation is happening. And last 2-3 years, I think more aggressively, the transformation process is moving, which brings some lights going forward properly. Energy for all, which is a Prime Minister dream, is there. And affordable energy to everyone. I think that's the mission is moving in the right direction. But when we see the whole power sector scenario is still heavily is a depend on the government and state government systems. As and when it's become a more and private public partnerships, relation in a full value chain, not just restricted to the generation area, but it's a full value chain with the generation, transmission and distributions, and it become a more and more efficient. So that is the one area is there. The three major points are very important for the consumer perspectives: availability, affordability, and reliability. I think that's the becoming a key drives for the any manufacturing unit in this country, or consumers, or the industrial loads, or the commercial requirement. The availability part is we have a fragmented architects of the energy distribution is there. The, some of the states has a rich energy production. Some of the states has a deficit in the energy requirement. So how we can integrate, these are the issues, and make the uniform. So it should be a one the electrons, one tariff, and one nacelle, rather than distributing in so many the states affairs on the power sector area. So these are the segments are, it's a concern area for the power. The third important is the health and financial condition of the our utility. Because they are passing through the lots of turbulence and other things, because lots of cross-subsidy issues, plus farmer in priorities areas are there, because they cannot able to afford the certain energy cost. But who will subsidize that? The industries has to subsidize. And because of that, the loads and demands are not growing.
Siji, lately have you seen, in the last 3-5 years, have you seen government do anything positive or negative that has affected your business?
I think the transformation process is going very well, but it's a long process for the power sector, because whole sector is driven by the different state. So that is a positive side. Uday scheme has bring the more and more efficiency and improve the health condition of the utility. I think that is the good the initiative has happened. The coal related and other issues was the lots of uncertainty was there. I think more or stabilized, but still it is a hand-to-mouth. Some of the utilities are running on a coal supplies area. So that is the still challenge is there. But root cause area is the whether consumers are comfortable, happy, reliability, availability, and affordability. I think that is the area it's still the big question mark in that. Another positive side, after the new government, I think 175 gigawatt renewable energy target, which is a very good positive move and very ambitious target, has the bring for the wind and solar sector growth. I think these are the good part is a moving on a right directions.
So can people like him join you and give you two windmills for each plant?
Absolutely. You know, what we are really trying to do is to be part of the government's work of providing energy access to the 304 million people who still don't have any ways of getting reliable, sustainable energy. So this would be really welcome. I think, you know, what we really are seeing that the decentralized renewable energy route is going to be really, very important to serve the needs of these 40 million people, 40 million households that the Prime Minister said. And we at Rockefeller have been investing significantly in ensuring that through the mini-grid technologies, we're really able to provide reliable energy to villagers across now 106 villages is where we're working in UP, Bihar, and Jharkhand, where the customers are getting energy, not just for lighting purposes, but most importantly for productive use. Because at the end of the day...
Can I interrupt?
Yeah.
Do you work in villages which already are on the connected with power grid, or these are villages which have never seen power?
So we have a mixture of both. And with the electrification targets of the government, you've seen that 10% electrification means a village is electrified. We have many such villages. But are all the households connected? Certainly not. And also, our mini grid operators, in spite of the grid electricity being there, are seeing consumers still buy electricity from the mini grid operator. The reason being they want reliable, quality electricity. They want to hold the mini grid operator accountable to be providing energy when they need it, because their economic development and their opportunities are dependent on access to reliable power. So in spite of the grid being there, the mini grid operators, the private sector is thriving in that situation. And the rural consumers are extremely happy because it's a virtuous cycle. They are able to really enhance their livelihoods.
So in which state are you most successful of these?
I think right now, because of the energy serving company that we are working with, it's more because of the energy serving company, I would say Jharkhand, where we work with Melinda. But UP, I must say, has really been very, very encouraging for us. We have 75 mini grids operating in UP. We have the government have, UP was the first government to come out with a mini grid policy. Mm-hmm. And what was really interesting is not only did they have a mini grid policy, but they had regulations that were speaking to the policies. And they're deeply committed to having an implementation plan as well, so that it just doesn't remain on paper.
So you think economies of scale can work like this? Because you are somebody who deals with larger plants and larger efficiencies.
I think we need a combination of both. So while distributed power lends itself to inclusion, but then if you see the practical utilization of renewable power currently in India is about 20%. So for say for 100 megawatt that you install, you actually only produce worth 20 megawatt, which means you've got to rely again on the large power stations. And that is where I think you also need to have improvements in the way we construct and build the power plants. We do it in more predictable time frames, and we also do it in a less socially disruptive manner. Meaning, for example, if you now have a large project, there are some projects where there are, for example, 130,000 people being brought to the site. Now, that's traumatic for the place where you build in 30. So if you can have new construction technologies, for example, like advanced modularization, where you can build elsewhere and not disrupt the city or the village that you're building plant, that can help.
Otherwise, demographics can change because labor comes and labor doesn't always
go. So while some people do get benefited, but there is a lot of social disruption also which happens. And if projects are done on time, then there'll be less stress on the banks also. So, I mean, we don't realize, but if a 42-month project is completed in 54 months, you can imagine, you know, the banks and the lenders, they get their monies later, and therefore they don't then fund newer projects.
So you work with a lot of industry, which either works in power or depends on power, or co-generates power, oil and gas. You obviously saw stress there about 3 years back. What is the state of that stress now? Has it lessened? Has it worsened?
Well, if you see the private development, that's almost vanished, as Tulsi was saying, particularly in the power and combined cycle, with the lack of availability of gas at a convenient pricing. The government projects are still going on, the large projects in the coal sector. And I think there is, in terms of coal production, now there are even higher targets set. So I think both have to go together. Somehow coal has made the villain, and there seems to be less of an interest in making it work well. I believe we need both, and it is in the country's interest that attention is paid to both.
But does India have a coal addiction?
Well, I wouldn't say. I mean, there are other countries which have a lesser dependence on coal. But then they have been there in so many years earlier. And given the size of our country, and also the fact if you see coal, say solar again, it is not as well distributed as coal is. So a majority of the solar power plants are concentrated in a smaller number of states. And then you have these issues of I'm told there is severe curtailment of the power that is produced from the solar plants. So if it's produced, but the utilities are not buying it because the systems are not strong enough to go back and forth, because the power that is produced from solar is not 24 hours. It's not fully predictable. Now, of course, people are building systems to make it more predictable, but it's going to take time. And therefore, you need to, again, depend on base load generation, which has to come from coal.
So, Amit Narayan, founder and CEO of AutoGrid, while you say your own piece, do you have a solution to this problem? Can you make solar power more predictable and more stable?
Yeah, so I mean, we like to say that globally, not just in India, actually, software and intelligence is actually going to play an equally big role, if not bigger, than the infrastructure improvements that are happening. And I think the Indian problems are obviously unique and specifically on the utility side, more severe than global problems, but the utility model, which has been set up for more than 100 years and has worked so well, is under massive disruption globally. I mean, we work with utilities in North America, we work with utilities in Europe, Japan. The fundamental problem that they face right now is that globally, electricity has been considered as an enabler of progress. And it has been, the rates have been designed in a way that you end up treating it almost like a tax, right? So for every commodity, if you buy more of that commodity, your marginal price typically goes down. With the utilities, the rates are such that if you consume more, not only do you pay more, you actually pay per unit price, which is higher as well. And so that's why the industrial customers are paying for the subsidies, are paying subsidies for the residential customers, and in India's case, it's particularly bad because there are some customers who are fully subsidized.
Who are paying nothing.
Yeah, who are paying nothing for this.
So this experiment of separating the grids, the feeders, has that worked?
Well, so, I mean, I think we will have a lot of different solutions. So the places where there is no grid, I think that justifying building a new grid is going to be hard, because the prices of solar and even with batteries are coming to a point where building this infrastructure, which is going to get only partially used, is going to be hard. But places where you already have made those infrastructures, you don't want to just throw it away, because there is tremendous value in that infrastructure. And you really want to be able to see how you optimize your systems and derive maximum value out of it. And so there are some massive opportunities in India, I mean, as we talk to some of the utilities here, to use digital technologies and essentially get their operations more efficient. It's not just about reducing theft. Of course, you can reduce theft, and you should reduce theft, and whatever can be done should be done. But fundamentally, the inefficiencies come because you are not able to balance demand and supply. Even when we talk about India has surplus, the surplus is, I attended a few panels today, and it seemed to me that it's projected as a success story, and it is a success story. But at the end of the day, it doesn't mean that the amount of electricity that India is generating is sufficient to meet the demand of the consumer. All it means is that the utilities are not in a financial position to even buy.
So do we have a surplus because people are not able to buy? Indirectly, because utilities are not able to
buy. Right.
And also, do we have an excess demand because industry is not picking up power, people are not using it, growth has slowed down?
Maybe. I mean, I'm sure there is the truth is somewhere in between, but there is definitely pent-up demand if you can supply the power at the right price. Now, the problem in India is that the electricity prices are actually low, like by global standards, 8 cents, 10 cents are one of the lowest prices. But in terms of purchasing power parity, they are quite high. So the utilities are not, it's not that easy for them to raise the prices without facing a backlash. So really they need to make their operations more efficient. And if you look at the, I mean, I was just checking the IEX prices yesterday just out of curiosity.
What is IEX? The energy exchange,
where you are trading. And if you look at the prices in the night, typically 3 a.m., you're paying ₹3.90 for electricity. In the peak hours, around 7, 8 p.m., you are paying around ₹8.50. So just within a day, there's a 2.5x differential. Now, the end consumer is not really exposed to any of that. So if you are intelligent about the prices and you are optimizing your operation so that the people who are getting subsidized, whether these are farmers who are getting free electricity,
so people will go to bed early and wake up really early morning.
Well, that's where technology comes in. So now, I mean, like we have a solution here with partners. We don't do any hardware, but most of it is like with Internet of Things, ubiquitous connectivity. You can basically create remotely controllable switches, and you can basically automate it. It's not rocket science. It's actually very mainstream technology which is out there. If you roll it out to a few million consumers, every number adds up here. We just talked to a chief minister here. They can save 2,000 crore rupees over 5 years just by optimizing their electricity usage in a utility. That comes with an equivalent benefit to the consumers. As you said, like right now they're doing power cuts. They turn off the whole feeder. They give power only in the night. Farmer has to go there, walk there. I mean, there is a lot of danger around snake bites and all of these things. Bichu kaat lega is what the phrase I heard, basically. So if you have automation, you can get rid of all of that inconvenience, and you can shift the load to places where you have excess generation but not enough demand, and balance the whole thing out. And of course, storage plays a very big role in this whole equation, because you now have the capability to do it in a very micro targeted manner at a finer granularity. So that's really, I feel that's the big opportunity. And the more a system is inefficient, the more you have these lower hanging fruits that you can take advantage of and squeeze more out, more value out of it.
So the big change we had when this government came in was the Uday scheme. Is everybody familiar with the Uday scheme?
Heard about it, yeah.
Heard about it. Are you familiar with it, Deepali? Have you dealt with it?
Heard about it.
Heard about it. Yes. So I think you are the closest to it in terms of having users. So just explain the Uday scheme and give us a view on whether it has worked or not.
No, Uday scheme concept-wise...
Uday was a scheme where whereby the liabilities of... You explain it. Liabilities were shifted from one side to the other in the hope that state governments will be more responsible.
Yeah. So main the Uday scheme is, the basic theme is how to make utility more and more efficient. The first objectives, okay, whether it is a plant or a systems and cost and other areas, so how to reduce that so that it become a indirect savings for their financial, the strength and other thing. The second area was also very important, okay, which are the plant or system is so old or so highly inefficient, which is expensive is there, but we are using and running and everything. So how to discontinue and to move to the more renewable sites, so that we can accommodate those.
But the central thing was to park the liabilities of DISCOMs onto state government.
State government.
And load them on the budget.
Correct.
Is that working?
Yeah, because the one side we have to incentivize or benefit some of the segment of the society or the farmers. Now who will be the loads go? It has to be transferred to the state government, the budget systems. So that is the mechanism. So some of the state has done very good moment on that. I think best good example I can say Rajasthan. So they have done really efficient work on this area, and bring back their financial stability and everything is a very efficient way. So other state is moving and developing on that. But this is not the only solutions in our the segment area. When we are talking about the system issues, the night power is surplus and the low cost is there, peak power is there. I think two, three areas is important. One is the energy architect is base load is also required, and the renewable load is also required. So that mix is very important for each state portfolio, and how all the states should be interconnected with the natural highways of the grid infrastructure. So it can be flow the electrons more easily and without the borders. Because that is the root cause is there. So if you remove that, the cost of energy will further go down and consumer will get the low cost of energy. Second, consumer side is also required lots of change, behavior change. Okay, when and how, what energy I can use in 24-hour cycles. Because there is a big infrastructure invested for the peak. But lots of number of hours in the day, we are not utilizing that. So required of digital technology, smart metering system, hour based pricing. Okay, in particular hour you are consuming, you have to pay for this. If you are consuming particular hour, you can get the lower. So that will reduce the lots of disparity in the systems.
You deal with the consumer at the most distant end of the chain.
Mm-hmm.
And she's also not the richest consumer. She's usually the poorest consumer. You see Indian consumer figuring this out, that if I do this, if I run my washing, middle class household, if I run my washing machine at 4 in the morning or 5 in the morning, it's much cheaper than running it after I come back from work and I've done the dinner for the family.
I think rural consumers are very smart. They need, if they get the right information, they will definitely, there will be a change in behavior. And I, you know, we have been doing that because even with the work that we're doing, you know, it's about educating them and saying, you know, what would really be in your best interest. And they get it. They really do get it. So I strongly believe that, you know, there could be a really important role that media can play, communication organizations can play in really getting this messaging out, and behavior change will definitely make a huge difference.
At this point, any questions, please raise your hand and feel free to join in. We'll keep on talking, but don't wait for us to finish or we'll take up all the time. So any questions, any interventions? Sir, if you would introduce yourself and ask a brief question.
Sandeep Anand from All Cargo. This question is for Mr. Tanti. With the new tariff at 2.64, how do you foresee renewable energy going ahead? Will we be able to sustain at 5,000 megawatts a year?
No, first of all, there is a chicken and egg situation is there. The country need low cost of energy. And if the low cost of energy is available, the volume and size will be the bigger. So initially, we have to pay for that. We have to suffer for because of the lower pricing and tariff. But because of that, we see the size of the market, which today is 3 gigawatt or 5 gigawatt is there, it will go to the 10 gigawatt size.
You think scale will
scale
compensate
will give. But whether first scale will come or whether low price will come first. So it's a starting point.
Or will the banks go first?
Right? Absolutely. So now this pricing is really low. We agree with you also. But it is in the wind, we have to see which are the state has a very high wind velocities, Tamil Nadu and Gujarat. So all this bid has gone in two states, number one. Number two is within the state, which is the site has a very high wind velocities. Particular those sites in this 1,000 megawatt has gone. The third is the next generation of the turbine which we are bringing in, because this project we have to do after within 18 months. So whatever the next generation turbine is coming in the next year, which is the higher PLF and lower cost product is there. So that will support in that. But if I say the nutshell, the system point of view, it is required initially, but if the volume is coming, it's affordable. If volume will not come, then it's not affordable. So that is the one. The second is banking system point of view. They are concerned if below 3 rupees pricing of the renewable energy, is they are afraid about the funding and financing area. Because they believe is that it's very difficult to service the debts and other things. So that is will remain a concern areas for this segment. Why it is happening is there, it is an unfortunate situation because it's a reverse bidding systems is there. If you say, let's take our the road infrastructures, we are doing a lot of biddings and everything. There is no reverse bidding system is there, but it's a closed bidding system, but transparent bidding system is there. If we bring that in this renewable sectors for the power purchase concept point of view, it must require the closed bidding system, like 500 megawatt Tamil Nadu state has done closed bidding system, which give the stability of the pricing. Otherwise, it will be too low, too competitive situations.
But Tulsi ji, Tamil Nadu is not the best example of
I agree with you.
Of a state utility.
Yeah.
In fact, they are among the worst.
Yes. And not able to pay certain timelines and other things is there. So that's why the solution is there to protect the manufacturing and to protect the growth and to same time give the low cost of energy to consumer. I think the closed bidding systems with the full transparency, I think better solution, the way road infrastructure projects, bidding and everything is happening. So then the development can be continue and banks should be more comfortable. That is the area of also our concern.
But this low cost of power, I mean, tends to be... I think it's more a myth. I mean, if you look at the millions of diesel generators that are working in India, I mean, in my house, I mean, I have a backup generator. I get charged 21 rupees and I pay it.
Everybody does. I mean, each one of us is a sovereign republic.
So to say that all manufacturers only want 3 rupees power, I think is also a myth. I'd rather that, as he said, for the utilities to be charging 7 or 8, so that you're there, you're not charging 3, but you're not charging 21 either. And with 8, their finances would be better. They would be able to buy power, and then the manufacturing industries would be able to use it. So I think it's an artificial target that we have set for ourselves, that everything should be low priced. I mean, we are converting low price into a virtue in itself, to the negation of everything else, to the negation of reliability, to the negation of quality.
I think it's the most passionate defense I've heard for high prices.
But I think the nuance is that...
You don't have future in politics, I can tell you.
I think the nuance is that even in spite of low prices on the generation side, because there is a bottleneck in the transmission and distribution network, you are not able to get that power to the customers reliably, right? So,
yes.
So I think it's not clear whether the utilities can just raise prices a little bit and they will be able to solve this problem. I think it's really around intelligently optimizing things. So, I mean, like, I think a big use case that we are seeing in India right now is diesel replacement, because you said diesel is at 21 rupees, we were doing 17.
Diesel power,
like just running, like not the capex. Now, at that price, actually battery, even with today's pricing, is cost effective. You can replace diesel just on the OPEX. So if you can use that, and you can create a business model where utilities are able to take advantage of that somehow, and there are many different examples around the world which can be followed. In my backyard, California has very progressive policies around storage deployments. Australia, Germany, I mean, their storage is becoming viable. I think you can start gradually improving the health of the overall system. And I think that the fact that we have so much room now because of the wind prices coming down and solar prices coming down, you can actually use some of that room to pay for the infrastructure upgrade that is needed on the storage side. In fact, in China, we are seeing a lot of projects on wind, which come with a requirement that you have to put a certain amount of storage with that. So I don't know if that started happening here or not.
It will start very soon in India.
Right.
But
yeah.
One thing you remember, the low solar, you know, pricing is, I mean, everyone's claiming credit for it. But if there is any credit for that, it should go to the Chinese manufacturers,
sure.
Who's pricing. So it is contrary to our goal of Make in India. And when you put solar power plants, you don't generate even one-tenth of the jobs that you generate when you build coal plants or nuclear plants. So there might be a seeming near-term benefit, but if you look at it more holistically, I think the smart thing to do is to have all types of generation and not just say, this is the best.
No, that's, I think, the wind is more successful in India. Even
yeah,
we
wind,
are,
I'm talking about solar.
Yeah, solar
but,
is heavily we are importing.
But the Chinese now have a monopoly in solar power equipment?
100%.
100%.
Four to five companies, 90% global market in their control. So that is not just India, but world.
And there's nobody in India who can compete at
no,
those prices.
No, it is possible, because then it's required a regulatory policy frameworks to here.
Well, then
first,
which means it requires protection.
No, protection is initially, but after that, when we become a scale and sustainable, then there is
I
no
mean,
protection.
Once,
is it?
Once protection is
initial
given, it
initial incentive was there in wind. Now today, there is no any fiscal benefit is there. And $4 or 3 rupees power is available. Is
Deepali, you can't have all these people promoting high prices for power.
No, I cannot. But I think, you know, for me, what's really important is, let's go back to, you know, there are 304 million people in India who don't have access to energy. What can we really do to make sure, you know, there's excess, but it's not getting to them? So I think, you know, let's really see what's the best way of really getting energy to them in the fastest way possible. Through the work that we've been doing, in 4 to 6 weeks, you can electrify a village. You can ensure people have access to energy, not just for lighting, for productive use. They can increase their income by 13% on a monthly basis. We've seen that happen. So I think for us, let's look at more of a holistic approach that is really going to work for everybody across India, not just for a few. And we have a real situation. Niti Aayog has said 304 million people still don't have access to energy. It's really, it's not the India that we, any one of us, want to be a part of, you know. So I think, you know, for all of us to really put our heads together, to work with government around really coming out with integrated energy plans, where there's a role for the grid, there's a role for decentralized renewable energy, and whatever is in the best interest of our rural consumer should be the solution, and give them the choice, you know. They'll make smart decisions.
Yep. No, so I think in this area, the excess of energy, 300 plus million population doesn't have. in the last 10 years as per our some of the projects which we have built in a rural part of the countries. The root cause problem of the excess of energy is a grid infrastructure is not available.
Mm-hmm.
By building the wind power project on those area, almost 50 to 60 million population in last 10 years, our project has given excess of energy. Because earlier grid was not there, wind was there. So we have gone there, we have built the infrastructure, we built the substation and line, and they got the connections. So this is the way the indirect development is happening, because there is a lots of resources are available, but excess of grid is not there. So that will change the dynamics. But I agree with you, 300 million is not a small thing. Whole America is equal to that, right. Nearly we can go. So we have to work very hard on this area.
And why should it be indirect? Why don't we make it direct and core and center of the overall approach that the national government would have?
Yes.
So how scalable is your model? You're doing 106 villages mm-hmm. in three states.
Mm-hmm.
It's great work, but it's only 106 villages out of thousands, mm-hmm. maybe tens of thousands.
Yeah.
How scalable is your model?
That's a very good question, Shekhar.
Will only NGOs do it or non-profits do it, or can it be done commercially?
This is being done by the private sector. So there are seven energy serving companies who are running these mini grids and running them quite successfully. I think in the immediate future, there is definitely going to be need for blended financing. The sector is still not ready to attract commercial capital. But I think if we can put in the right measures in place over the next couple of months, they will get closer. But I think the role of subsidy is still going to be important before the sector is really at a stage of maturity.
And who gets that subsidy? Does the consumer get the subsidy, or does the provider or producer get the subsidy?
So as of now, it's the producer who's getting the subsidy
and
under the current law.
All right.
Hi, I'm from Reuters. I have a question. Since there was a discussion around prices and tariffs, and since that there was one question on the lower tariffs that we've seen, and you said Tamil Nadu is not an ideal example for it, but off late, I mean, given the kind of slump we've seen in these tariff rates and the fact that coal associations and coal lobbies have been talking about how these models are really not sustainable with the kind of tariffs we are seeing, plus the fact that solar and wind generation should ideally serve as ancillary power sectors and not really be brought to the forefront has been the thrust so far of the government. So as Mr. Gupta rightly asked about the scalability of the sector overall, so I would like to ask Mr. Tanti for his perspective.
No, it's a...
First of all, are you happy to be accorded the place of an ancillary player in power business?
No, but we are naturally, we are the part of the power sector and value chain. So we have to face plus and minus both the side, and we have to live with this environment. I think the pricing is continuously, last 20 years is continuous debatable question is there. So if it is two things are, whether consumer can get the affordable energy or not. Answer is one segment of the consumers, yes, but one segment of the consumer, no. So that is the one scenario is there. Now generating is the one segment is there, but there is no full system control. We are not transmitting, we are not distributing. So whole thing is again goes to the pool. So generation side has quite come house the low cost of energy, fine. But end consumers, whether it is industries or commercial or other area, the cost of energy has not yet reduced, because overall financial systems of the utility, it still is a question mark, areas are there. So if we can address those, then the whole ecosystems, the generator to consumers, I think that becomes the balance. Otherwise, it still remain in a gray area. But the best part is there, renewable costing, because of the scale is increasing, volume is increasing, the new product and technology has become more reliable and more mature and everything. So the continuous pricing is giving a good benefit. Same time, if we remove the certain old infrastructure, old power plants, old the assets, and discontinue that energy production and convert into there, because this segment is going closer to the consumers, because it's not a concentrated power plant production, whether it is solar or wind, highly distributed in a different segment, and it is on a tail end of the grid infrastructure. So it is strengthening the grid system and bringing another thing. And that is why if we see the last 2 years, the 60% new energy investment has come from the renewable only. So that is a moving thing. It's not just in India. the whole world in the last 2 years is a $1 trillion investment has happened in the power sector. Out of $600 billion has come from the renewables.
60% is
renewables. Yeah, 60% is, so now no more is alternate energy. It's a mainstream. And the scale is giving a continuous, the pricing benefit. Initially, we feel uncomfortable, but going forward, it is there. Only this bidding process can change, will bring the stability. Otherwise, it is a creating a very high impact.
Because of reverse auction. Yeah.
I just want to add one point. I think when you talk about scalability, also what we are seeing is some of our private sector companies that we are working with, they're able to attract commercials. So, for example, OMC has just got $9 million from Mitsui. So, you know, there is a lot of scope and opportunity for this work to expand.
I think, you know, when we talk of any particular means of production, whether it's solar, I think we need to look at overall costs. So while, say, for example, for solar or wind, the cost may be lower, but then you have to have an additional cost for strengthening the transmission system for really being able to use solar. So then you have to see, and if you do those studies and actually look at the total costs, you may find that all systems can work equally efficiently, and therefore one is not to be dumped. And again, I think he briefly referred to about stability. I think you need to have some long-term predictability of policy also. So a few years ago, the government said, mandated that for coal power plants, you should invest in India. So several large companies, L&T, Bharat Forge, they've built huge capacities, and now they're not being used. Like thousands of crores have been spent, both the industrious money as well as the bankers' money. And now there are no plants coming up. So again, because the pendulum has now swung towards renewables. So I think we need more stability and more mature, holistic decision-making rather than being driven by the event of the day.
You have a question?
Yes.
Microphone will come to you. Just give it a second. Magically drops in your lap, yes.
Hi, my name is Pushkar Kulkarni and I'm from Canada Pension Plan Investment Board. There was a lot of discussion around price and what producers bid at. I think somewhere in the Indian developer psychology, there is this need to grab every project that gets tendered out. And this race for getting market share actually has played itself out in the infrastructure sector so badly. And one of the reasons for a lot of these stranded plants was, one, a short-term vision to quickly make money, maybe recycling the EPC margins and let the lenders be left high and dry. I think there is a need, and I wanted to ask this question to this panel, for the lenders to get smarter and not fund projects that have been bid unviably, which will then in turn make this bidding viable and get it to a level which is really able to then make some sustainable profits, which makes the industry more stable. And some views from that, from the panel.
I think they can respond, but I wish the lenders had been given this advice earlier, because now they've gone bankrupt already.
Yep. Well, I mean, I just want to make one comment, because I mean, when the low price auctions happened in Mexico, and in other parts, Chile and all that, everybody raised the same alarm bells and said that these projects are not going to be viable, NL is going to lose money and things like that. But none of these projects have actually been canceled. They are, so the prices are indeed coming down. It's getting forced, and it's a bit of a treadmill because you have to like keep the prices down and still your profits remain the same. But it's not that, like by definition, we should assume that these projects are just going to fail, basically, right? So I think the jury is still out whether these projects will be viable or not.
You see that play out in thermal, in roads, you name it, and you have so much stranded assets, all a lot because of rash bidding. So it's
well,
may not have happened yet.
No, that is why the solution is.
Have you done any rash biddings? Confession time.
No, because we have to competitive. That is a must require. Otherwise, you are out of the game. It's not the situation. Somebody can able to afford. Why not you can able to? So it's required a continuous investment in a technology, the scale, and manufacturing process cost reduction. I think that is the driving the cost area. So that is number one. But same time, reliability of the asset and other thing is equally important. The process of the bidding is good, But reverse versus close bidding is a very important, because otherwise it will damage the sector fast. That is the issue, sir.
Sir, did you have something to add? Then we go to that question, and I think we're coming to.
See, I had. My name is Shumanto. I'm from TCS. See, I had a couple of questions around the political side of power. The first question is, you know, India is a country where governments have won or lost depending on the land acquisition processes. Given that, is the alternate sector of power viable and scalable, you know, the renewables, is it viable and scalable?
Because it consumes a lot of land.
It consumes a lot of land. That's number one. The second part is, you know, as per the constitution, power is in the concurrent list, which means it is both the union and the state's responsibility. Is that time to change? I mean, when we're talking about one nation, one market, you know, when you have fights among states about the wheeling charges, and somebody gives power free and becomes, you know, benevolent for near the election time, is it time to change it from the concurrent list?
I think absolutely right, your question, and that is the root cause problem issues are there. Because if you bring the central systems for the power sector across the India, is the best solution, number one. Number two, the private and public partnership in a full value chain of the power sector. Right? What is happening? Generation done by the private sector, distribution done by the public sector. It is not the solutions. It has to be full value chain. So these are the two corrections. The central and state has to work as a partnership to this sector point of view, not the regulations and frameworks are coming from central and the state is implementing. One state say, no, I will implement like this. One state say, I will implement like this. And there is a no uniformity is a coming out. So these are the two major transformation of the overall power sector will bring a really great future of the power sector.
Well, I think those are very good wishes, and I think those are good wishes to conclude with.
Yes.
The issue with power is it's becoming a very political thing.
Yes.
So pricing of power, who gets power, where does the grid go, and then who gets the contracts, and no government wants to give up that power.
Correct.
We are a strange country where we've all got mobile phones before we've got electricity. And one of my colleagues has done a story for the Washington Post when she used to work there in the past, talking about how people in Gorakhpur, our UP chief minister's hometown, go running to the highway to hook their phone onto the main supply line to charge them because they have no power at home to charge it. In my own experience, I've seen a new e-commerce business coming up in rural India where these are straightforward mobile shops. They'll charge your mobile, but they also have a computer, so they can do your Aadhaar registration, they can do your passport application, your account opening, they can file your tax returns if you have to. And you ask them, how do you find power for this? They point to a panel sitting outside by the road.
Yeah.
And there's a cable that's running in. So people are finding their own little ways of finding power, which is not the right way to do it.
Mm-hmm.
I think some of the wishes expressed are very good. I think you, one of the... I think the gentleman there suggested, and you agreed, that there should be a constitutional amendment whereby states should lose some powers over wheeling of power.
Yes.
I can, you know, with my limited knowledge of politics, I can totally assure you no such thing will happen, because there is no way a state will give up any power that it has today. In fact, states want more power.
Right.
And in fact, that's the future of Indian politics, and that's the future of Indian reform or Indian economy, that states will now compete. The more prudent states will go ahead, more industry will go there, they will have happier citizens, they'll collect more taxes, and the less prudent states will see a flight of capital. And I think it's a good idea that the states will compete, because to imagine that there will be constitutional amendments where states' powers can now be reduced is an impossibility. That's not going to happen. But many other things have to happen. We need more models like Deepali's. Why just 106? Maybe 10,006. And may there be many more organizations like yours that do it, because India will always have so many gaps in so many areas. So we need bit of everything. You need to bring efficiencies. You need to teach people to do things at the right time. And I think if economics is right and people also pay accordingly, right now that doesn't happen, not with domestic. But once that starts, I think we'll be better off. And you, when you really get down to about half a megawatt on your nuclear power plants, do let me know. My neighborhood may be interested, and maybe that's my retirement plan. So
maybe someday.
Thank you very much. It's been a wonderful panel. And frankly, I have learned a lot about your business. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.